Good morning, South Africa. Right now, though, it is quickly time to take a look at your tech daily developments. We have the general manager of bandwidthblog.com, Brian Smith, with us in studio to take a look at some of the new happenings in the world of tech. Brian, lovely to have you, brother.
Thank you for having me.
How are you doing this morning?
I'm great, and yourself?
Not too bad, not too bad. Okay, so let's talk about space news for a second here. The Cassini spacecraft, all right, it has been decommissioned now, but how has it helped kind of us look at space in a different way over the past 20 years?
So Cassini's actually responsible for a majority of what we know about Saturn. It was launched in 1997. It's been 7 years in transit to Saturn. And for the past 13 years, it's been monitoring not only the composition of Saturn's atmosphere, but also its rings and its series of moons. In its journey, it's taken nearly 500,000 photographs, and it's discovered
wow.
6 moons around Saturn that we didn't know existed previously.
Sure, okay, so it did really mean a lot in terms of space exploration, what is out there, but a very dramatic exit for Cassini. Why so?
There are actually 2 reasons, and both of them are very important to the future of space exploration. The first and most natural one is perhaps there's no better way to study the impact of entry into a planet's atmosphere than sending a satellite directly into it. So that's exactly what Cassini did. It beamed back a series of images before plummeting into Saturn's atmosphere and being destroyed in the abyss, so to speak. Secondly, there's a more of an environmentalist activist role at play here in terms of space exploration. So 2 of Saturn's moons, being Titan and Enceladus, have water which we believe may be capable of supporting life. Now, given that obviously Cassini came from Earth, had a series of microbes on it, who knows what from our atmosphere, we don't want to potentially impact another planet's ecology. So it makes sense to destroy the satellite in the most convenient way possible.
All right. Well, there we go. Thank you very much, Cassini, for supplying us with some awesome images. Nearly 500,000, you say. That's incredible. Something quite closer to home right now from the Wits University. We're talking about something called the Raspberry Pi computer and the fact that scientists have managed to connect brain waves to it. Exactly, unpack that a little bit for us.
So this is actually a really exciting development out of South Africa from Wits University this week, in that a team of researchers from Wits have now managed to decode and transmit the electrical activity from a human brain to a Raspberry Pi computer, which is a very cheap elementary form of PC.
Gee, that is so what will that essentially mean? I mean, going forward, this type of tech being able to do that?
It has a host of very interesting applications. One among them, if you think of Elon Musk of Tesla and SpaceX fame, what Elon's been trying to do is create what's called a neural lace to bridge the divide between the human mind and software, hardware, and technology in general. Yeah. And what this could lead to is, firstly, it could help us refine artificial intelligence by studying the human activity from brainwaves and being able to decode them. Secondly, which is really the more fascinating implication, is that if we can download and receive electrical activity from the human brain, we may one day be able to send information back up that stream.
That's what I wanted to ask you. Can it work in reverse?
It's potentially possible. If we can decode this information and now study the way that the brain can send these signals down to the Raspberry Pi computer, we may be able to reverse engineer that process.
My goodness. And the fact that it comes out of here, our home ground, is pretty awesome as well. Brian, thank you very much for joining us this morning. Really appreciate it. That's your Tech Daily Update right here on your Feel Good Breakfast Show. Remember, if you want to get a load of all your tech stories, you can just visit bandwidthblog.com.